Good morning, church. I'm Jonah. This is Haley, Elisa, and Antonio. And we're going to lead you in worship this morning. Let's stand and worship together. Come on. I raise a hallelujah.
Louder than morning. Welcome to Hermitage Hills. My name is Michael Jenkins. I'm the student minister here. And if this is your first Sunday here, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. We're glad that you're here. Happy Father's Day to the fathers in the room and joining us via live stream. Absolutely. Absolutely. A month ago, obviously, we celebrate Mother's Day and we celebrate moms. And then today we celebrate dads. And dads have a difficult job, maybe a little different flavor than Mother's Day, but we celebrate you guys. It is a tough job. Maybe we diffuse it with dad humor, and that's okay. We're allowed that privilege. Also, dads, just at the end of the service, we just want to, again, celebrate you and just say, man, thank you. We've got a special gift for you that's going to be in the worship center lobby, and I'm going to need a close-up on this. This is going to be free advertisement for dad's soda. We've got dad's root beer, and we've got dad's cream soda. Hopefully we've got a close-up of this. And so anyways, dads, grab one on your way out. There you go, for you, for dads. There you go. And that'd be one more reason if you're joining us via live stream. Hey, we're saving a seat for you, because we'd love for you to join us. You can get 99% of everything on the website. Can't get the in-house experience. Hopefully, as everybody walked in, you were given a connection guide by one of our hosts. If you did not receive one of those, we've got hosts all over the room just to make sure you've got one. They've got their hand up. If you'd slip your hand up, they'll get you one. That way, you don't have to remember everything I said. I'm not going to say everything in here. That way, you've got it for you. But I want to direct your attention to a couple things. First and foremost, as you open it up, you'll see a card. It says the connection card. And maybe you're a guest this morning. Maybe this is your second time or third time, or you've been checking us out. And you're like, hey, you know what? I want to jump in a little bit more. All we ask if you're a guest or a visitor is just that you would let us know, hey, I'm new. This is my first time here, second time here. We just want to say thank you. And we will do that in the form of sending you a text, an email, handwritten card in the mail. There might be a little treat in there as well. So it's in your best interest to put an address in there. We're not going to stalk you, show up at your house or anything like that. We just want to, again, say thank you. Again, if you've got a prayer request, maybe you just want to let us as a staff know, hey man, something amazing has happened in my life. God has been good, and I want to share that as well. Every week, our staff gathers to pray over the needs of the church, to pray over the things that God has been doing in your lives, as well as the lives of our church, and we take that as a high privilege and a high honor. You know, you may also just be updating your address, cell number. That's a great way to do that as well. There's a lot of information about things going on in the life of our church. One of that would be Wednesday nights in the park. If you joined us this past Wednesday, first of all, it was beautiful weather. And so you enjoyed a great night at the park. But this Wednesday and next Wednesday, we're going to finish out the month of June at Charlie Daniels Park, Pavilion Number 2, to kind of give you the logistics and the layout there. That is the one directly next to the sand volleyball courts, the basketball courts, and the huge playground splash pad area. So it is accessible and fun for families and kids of all ages. Just maybe not the playground. I wouldn't fit on the playground, so there's that. But anyways, we invite you to just be part of that. Bring your own dinner, hang out with church family, invite a friend, talk to somebody there at the park, and just let them know, man, Hermitage Hills is a place that loves the community, and we just want to be out there and be together and let folks know that as well. There's a lot of things that we have an opportunity as summer hits, whether that has been BKC, and we've just been blessed by how God has been faithful in that. But we've got a few things coming up that we're going to take time to pray for. And one of those, you'll see on my right, the baptismal was set up this morning. And so in a second, we're going to pray for a lady named Tanya. Just a beautiful story of just what God's been doing through the ministry of Radical Heart over the past couple months. There's been folks that have been coming in and getting physical needs met, but also hearing about how they can get spiritual needs met through the message of Jesus Christ. And there was a lady this week that when she heard that message, she took a step and she placed her faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And then she immediately said, okay, now what? Like, what's stopping me from being baptized? And to which we said, amen, absolutely. And so we're a church that believes in people experiencing life change through Jesus Christ. And that just is one instance of that. So we were set up for that this morning, but unfortunately Miss Tanya needed to get some medical treatment this morning. And so that baptism has been put on hold. And we're going to pray for her in just a second while we pray for several other groups. But I wanted to make mention of Miss Tanya this morning. Also, this week, tomorrow, our kids and adults leave for kids camp. And so we're going to be praying for them. At the conclusion of our service, there's going to be students at each of our exits that are going to have prayer bracelets. I'm praying for Sadie Benz this week, so it'll have a child's name or an adult's name. Just, I would encourage you, grab one of those, put it on the rearview mirror of your car, or put it on your wrist, and just use that as a reminder to pray for that particular student or adult this week. But if you are a grandparent or a parent of a child going to camp, or you're an adult leader going to camp, in just a second, I'm going to ask you to stand. But then there's one more group that we're going to pray for. They leave this week, and that is the Italy mission trip team. They leave later this week. They're going to be going to Italy to work with the group that we have this past year as well. And I'm going to ask you to stand. There's 11 people on the team. Pastor Andy and Heather are out of town this week. They're getting their kids situated. But if you're going to Italy, I'm going to ask you to stand now so we can pray for you. And then if you are a grandparent or parent of a child going to camp or an adult leader going to camp, I'm going to ask you to stand. And as you stand, then I'm going to ask those of you that are near them, just gather around them, put your hand on them, put your hand on somebody close to them. And I'm going to give you a moment to pray for them, and then I'll pray for that in our offering. So if you're going on those trips, or your grandchild or child is going on those trip, if you'd stand, and as they're doing that, host, if you'll go ahead and come forward, that way we can pray for our offering and pray for these two trips, as well as Miss Tanya. So as you see folks that have stood, if you're near them or want to move near them, I'm going to ask that you do that. Just pray, just whisper a prayer over them for just a second. Let them hear you pray, and then I'll close in just a second. God, we thank you for the opportunity, God, to go, to carry your message. God, your word says that we ought to start right where we live, near where we live, and then ultimately the ends of the earth. And so, God, as we get to experience kind of both of those this week, as we pray for kids camp, God, as we think of the dozens and dozens and dozens of kids that are going away to camp for a week, there may be some nervous parents. But God, I also pray with expectancy that there's going to be evidence of life change. God, they're going to hear about you. They're going to learn more about you. They're going to hear the gospel. They're going to hear that there is one who loves them perfectly and forgives them of all that they've done. And there's going to be students, God, I pray, that are going to respond to that message in faith, trusting in you as Lord. So God, I pray for the adult leaders that are going. God, I'm grateful for them sacrificing a week to invest in the next generation. God, for this team that is traveling to Italy, God, I pray that they can convey the message of love through a language barrier, whether that be a smile, a hug, broken Italian. But God, that they would be hands and feet that would demonstrate the message of the gospel, so that when there are Italian boys and girls, Italian young men and women, that would hear a message that maybe they've heard a lot, God, that it would ring true, that it would be a truth that is cemented into their hearts and their minds. God, I pray this morning for Miss Tanya. God, that even maybe right now, God, she's receiving some medical care. God, I pray that we would just be grateful for her story. God, that we would be praying just for her health. God, that we're grateful there's doctors and nurses that are here in our area that can treat whatever the issue may be. We're grateful for the wisdom and the experience they've given. But God, we know ultimately care is in your hands. And God, we rejoice with her, that her intention this morning was to publicly announce, God, that she has followed you. God, we await for that day where she can do that. God, those are all examples of why we give and why we worship. So as we give and we continue to worship, God, we understand the call that you've placed on us to go, to take the message to our community and ultimately to the ends of the earth. So as we give now, God, I pray that you do that. You take the message that you are King Jesus, forgiver of all sins, that you love us, to those that need to hear it and respond to it in faith. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I have, when brokenness and pain is all I know, no, I won't be shaken, no, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love.
Would you stand with us?
Oh, shame no longer has a place to hide.
Bless the Lord. Ephesians 3, verses 17 through 19 say, "And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp just how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God." I pray that we'd be aware of our need of God and that we would just ask him as we continue to worship together that he would fill us to the measure of his fullness this morning. Amen. Let's continue to worship together.
You, I fall.
Your glory, God, is what our hearts We honor you in this place. We put you in proper authority over our lives and our hearts this morning. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your son, Jesus. So would you go before us even now and make a way? Give us eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts to obey what you've called each of us to do. It's in your holy and matchless, mighty name we pray. Amen.
Just let him rest on you today. Especially all you dads in the house. So grateful that you're here today. Thank you for all that you do and how you pray and love your spouse and love your family. Granddads, Randy, you're going to be granddad number two, I saw. A girl's coming. It's gonna rock your world, brother. Dads, thanks so much. Let me tell you about one of our dads. I know Mike told y'all about this gift for dads. We gave roses to the women. Yeah, it's root beer for the dads. All right. Or cream soda, wherever you like. But we thought this would be a fun thing to do. Like every year you think, okay, what are we gonna do? How are we gonna show appreciation to the dads? And so we saw this, really Brittany saw it, says, how about dad's soda on dad's day? What a great idea, right? Dads go home, fill that glass full of vanilla ice cream, pour a little root beer over it, woo, kick back and enjoy. Just take in a moment. But we started looking for these things. How many of y'all have ever seen dad's soda before? Anybody seen dad's soda? Okay, well, some of y'all. I'm behind. I'm sorry. I didn't know. And so we started looking to get some of these, and we couldn't find them. I went to Walmart. Ready? Walmart doesn't have it. Who ever knew Walmart didn't have something? You know what I'm saying? So we went everywhere. We started looking. One of our brothers, one of our dads, granddads in our church heard about this. And he said, Pastor, let me handle that for you. I went, brother, go for it. And he started searching. He started looking. Are you ready for this? This brother went to 13 Cracker Barrels. He went as far north as Kentucky. He and his wife drove around and went to 13 Cracker Barrels to make sure you dads were loved and appreciated and got a dad soda today. Now, I tell you that story because that's just the spirit of this place. That's just the spirit of our church. That's just the spirit here. And I just so appreciate that, you know. And then he paid for them all. Amazing. He said, no, brother, I got this. I want to be a blessing to my church, and I'm going to do that. So dads, make sure. Granddads, go for it. Psalms 119. Are you there? Let me invite you to open your Bible. If you don't have a Bible on your person, then please use it on your phone or iPad or wherever you have. Or the Bible is there in the pew right there in front of you. You'll find it on page 517, page 517 in the pew Bible, Psalms 119. We're going verse by verse through this longest chapter in the Bible, Psalms 119. It's pretty much in the center of the Bible. You'll find it, and we're just taking 176 verses. So we're going to go through July and then hit pause, and we'll come back next summer and hopefully finish it up. There's no way we're going to cover 176 verses in a couple of months. Just can't do that. And today we're talking about making my life count. How can you be someone who's going, man, I'm making my life count? What I'm doing as a dad, what I'm doing as a mom, what I'm doing as a single, what I'm doing as a married couple, what we're doing as a family, what I'm doing in my career. How do I walk through life and find myself looking around and going, my life really counted? I don't know of anyone who wants to look back and go, man, my life was worthless. My life didn't count for anything. How do you make a life that really, really counts? The psalmist is penning these words under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and he's referring, if you're new to the series, he's referring to Scripture over and over and over and over again. In different words and different phrases and in different ways, but throughout the whole chapter, he is emphasizing, re-emphasizing the value, the importance, and listen today, the authority of Scripture. So what you hold in your hand is not something just to use as when you need to or when you like to or when you get around to it. It is the very essence of your spiritual growth and your spiritual health. Now, we've seen and we've known for some time that many people don't even pay much attention to the Bible. In fact, the emphasis of this driven to desire is countercultural. It is countercultural to look to Scripture as the authority. And this is the word we're going to really emphasize. Making my life count is finding yourself under the authority of Jesus Christ as you follow him in what his Scripture teaches. So, don't raise your hand, don't say anything, don't elbow anybody next to you. How did your Scripture reading go this week? So let me ask you this. I will ask you to raise your hands on this. How many of y'all ate a meal at least once a day? Raise your hand. All right, if you didn't raise your hand, you got to come see me. I got to see what's going on there. But you successfully took in some nutrients, hopefully beyond just McDonald's, which is kind of my habit sometimes. But hopefully you're investing in the health of your body by eating healthy. Because what you eat is what you're going to become. Spiritually, it's true. Is the Scripture is that health order. It's that healthy place. So we see the struggle from the psalmist. Now, here's the deal. It can't be what we think or have experienced that is our source of authority. We go someplace more deeper, someplace more powerful. And that is what the psalmist is saying, is a commitment to God's word. The psalmist, again, is struggling as he writes this portion of Scripture. He's under attack because he will not give up or give in to the value and the authority and the importance of God's word. Now, we see this even in our own culture today very quickly. This is not a political statement. It is a biblical truth that I want to share with you. This is not a political statement. I don't know if y'all caught a week or so ago when Dr. David Platt at his church got a phone call from the president's security staff. And he got word as pastor of the church on a Sunday morning, President Trump is on his way to your church and he would like for you to pray for him. And so Dr. Platt said, absolutely. I see in 1 Timothy that we're commanded to pray for our leaders and pray for those with authority over us and pray for the kings. In this case, pray for the president. So he encouraged them, and they came. He got to meet with President Trump, got to share the gospel with President Trump, got to share God's love with President Trump. He brought him on stage, and as a church, they laid hands on him and prayed for the president. And it created an incredible uproar in the church. And he wrote an article about that. And go, if you haven't read it, you ought to read it. And been many commentators on this. Again, this is not a political statement. This is a biblical truth. We should pray for our president, whether he's Republican, Democrat, or whatever he may be, whatever side of the aisle he is on. We should want to pray for our president. But there were some who said, how could you do that? See, it's, you can sit in the pew and you can be very religious and you can say you love God, but you can miss the essence of the authority of Scripture when Scripture says, pray for your leaders. It didn't give any kind of caveat if their certain lifestyle is this way or they believe certain things this way or they're part of this particular party. It doesn't say that. It says you should be praying for your leaders. And some would say, well, maybe that was a political stunt on President Trump's part. Well, who cares? Publicly, we got to pray for the president. Publicly, we got to share the gospel with the president. And wherever you are with this individual, the office is still the office. And the truth of Scripture is still the truth of Scripture. Let me tell you something. Our churches in America today need a revival of the authority of God's word. And people in the church, I mean big C, not little C, big C, the church today has got to be drawn back to its roots of biblical truth and biblical principle and loving the Scripture and reading the Scripture and studying the Scripture and sharing the Scripture and obeying the Scripture, whether you really agree with it or not. To see God's word is God's word. And this is the psalmist is bringing this out throughout this chapter. How do you make your life count? It can be seen, put on the stage here for you. I hope you can capture this. Maybe the camera's good. This is just an illustration of a plumb line. If you're a builder, a contractor, or you work with building things, you know what this is, right? This is really, really important when you're building something. This is a plumb line. So here this plumb line is hanging here, and it's plumb, which means it's actually straight. It's perfectly straight because the weight of the plumb bob is pulling the string, is causing it to be plumb with the stage. So if I was going to build a wall here, I would take a board and I would make it right up to the edge of this string, and that would be straight. If it was off a little bit here or off a little bit here, it would be out of what? Plumb. Now listen, when you're building something and you want it square, you want it plumb, you want it to stand up right, there's a way to do it. And it has nothing to do with your personal experience or your personal opinion. It has to do with the law of the plumb line. And the reality is true, if you're just off a little bit up top, you're going to be off a whole lot more at the bottom. You see, God's word is my and your and our plumb line. It can't be seen as something we may look at or consider, but we see it as a law of life. And I want my life to be plumb. I want my life to stand through the test of time and the struggles of life. I want my life to really count. Let me tell you something. To make a life really count, it's got to be plumb to authority of Scripture. Now watch this. Wherever you get offline with the plumb line, the place of return is always the place of departure. The place of return is always the place of departure. So let's look at three things. Well, first of all, let's read. Stand together. Let's read verses 9 through 16. Let me try to break it down for three truths for your heart and your life to consider. Verse 9 through 16, God's word says, how can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart, I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips, I declare all the rules of your mouth. In the ways of your testimonies, I delight as much as in all the riches. That's a pretty huge statement. Verse 15, I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. I will delight in your statutes. And then these last six words, I will not forget your word. Now, it starts out, how can a young man keep his way pure? This is some argument to where they say David wrote this particular psalm. If you know anything about David's life, you know anything about David's journey and David's decisions and poor decisions and things that he walked through, they feel like how he was asking himself, God, how can I keep my life pure? How can I make my life really, really count? And then he tells, this is the path. I think it's pretty good item to consider today. Now, verses 9 through 16 doesn't mean it's just for young men. It's for all of us, equally applicable. Holy Spirit, we've sung it. You're welcome here. Holy Spirit, we know you're the teacher. Holy Spirit, take us deeper, further with you. You may be seated. So here we go. How can you make sure your life counts? Number one, every life needs boundaries. Every life needs boundaries. How do you make your life count? How do you keep your way pure? The psalmist puts it, by guarding it according to your word, by storing up your word in my heart. These are the set boundaries that God gives us. The word guarding is a verb. Every word we look at from this text specifically are a verb. That means they are an action word. It's not something to see and to know. It's something to understand and to follow. It is something to take action upon. It's a verb meaning to watch, to be careful, or to persevere. In many places, this same word guarding is used in Scripture for the word that means save oneself. Save oneself, as in the purity of one's virginity and in relationships before marriage. Now, let me hit pause here for just a second, because I just stepped into a hornet's nest by a statement, and I realized that. Remember I said when you yield to the authority of Scripture, you're going to go countercultural. We live in a day and age that we've lost the respect of others, where we take them and participate with them and join with them and acts in relationships that should never happen outside of one man, one woman, one life. See, but it's deeper than this. It impacts our daily choices, our career path, our friendships, our influence on others, our financial decisions, and on it goes. Guard it. Guard your way, guard your path, guard your choices, put up boundaries in your life. Remember, obedience brings order and order brings blessings. There are boundaries. If we ignore it or disregard it, I guarantee you it will lead to struggle and spiritual unhealthiness. Now look at the picture on the screen. Guardrails. We see these guardrails. They're there to protect you. As you drive down the road, you see the guardrails. These are the boundaries of the road. In other words, you go beyond this boundary, you're in trouble. You're probably going to go down some ravine. You're probably going to cause great harm and hurt to yourself. If you want to stay safe, if you want to stay healthy, if you want to stay on the path, follow the dynamics of the guardrails. Now, let me tell you something. They're just there to help you, but they don't prevent you. They can't stop you. And let me tell you why I know this. Years and years and years ago, I took a group of college students to Killington, Vermont on a skiing week, and on the way back in somewhere in New York, we hit black ice on this Greyhound bus, and that Greyhound bus went one side to the other side and finally went off the road. And there was a guardrail just like this, and we spun and we headed right straight toward that guardrail. And I thought the guardrail would like push us back on the right path. We hit that guardrail and I didn't even know it was there. And we went right through the guardrail and we went down the ravine a few hundred feet. It was the world's largest human bobsled. We went down and settled. See, the guardrail was there. It was to show us the path. It was to help us. It was trying to keep us in the right place, but it won't stop you. It can help you. But it's when you set up these boundaries through God's word, then we can be protected and healthy. See, guard is found 167 times in 159 verses in the Bible. Guard. It talks about guarding our mouths. It talks about guarding our knowledge. It talks about guarding our instruction, our path. Guard your steps, it talks about. It talks about guarding our spirit and guarding our faith. 167 times it tells us there's boundaries, there's boundaries, there's boundaries. Guard them, protect them, see them. Choose to stay within the boundaries. If my life is going to count, I've got to have biblical boundaries. Second, if my life's going to count, every life needs a teacher. How can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. Not personal opinion, my personal experience, but by your word. Verse 12, blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. The word teach, again, is a verb, meaning to learn, to find great success when it's attached to a teachable heart. Bless you, O Lord, the psalmist says, teach me, for I am teachable. Teach me because my heart is pliable. Teach me because my mind is open. Teach me exactly what your statutes are. I want to know them. I want to see them. I want to apply them. I want to live them. I want you to teach these to me. This is what the theme Driven to Desire is all about. It's about a radical understanding of biblical truths and scripture that would fill us with knowledge and understanding that we apply to everyday choices. A teachable heart is the path here. A teachable lifestyle is what the psalmist is calling the church to. Look what he says. With my lips I declare all the rules. Not some of the rules, not part of the rules, all the rules. Now the word rules, come on, that can rub us the wrong way. Rules can rub us the wrong way. And I'm not trying to express to you that I believe that Jesus is about a list of do's and don'ts. That's not what we're saying. But he is about a path. He is about boundaries. He is about teaching us those truths to our teachable hearts. The psalmist gives indication, with my lips I declare all the rules of your mouth. These rules are benefits and blessings. They're not to be seen as restrictive or restraining or robbing us of our joy. In fact, it becomes the source of our joy. It becomes the source of our strength and the peace through this life's journey. In fact, the psalmist admits he finds great delight in verse 16, great delight in these truths, and finds them greater than all the riches in verse 14. So he's saying, if you want your life to count, then you got to set up biblical truth as the boundaries of your heart, of the boundaries of your mind, of the boundaries of your choices. And as you're driving down the road of life with those boundaries, let the teacher Let Jesus, let his Holy Spirit continue to form you, make you, mold you within those boundaries of his word. My life counts when I stay in the boundaries, and my life counts when I submit with a teachable heart that is a great teacher who is Jesus. Every life, third, needs a mindset. These last six words, I will not forget your word. Now, let me tell you something. I had a birthday this week, and I turned 60. And forgetting, I need to find a pill to help me or something. I don't know. And it's not that we don't try. It's not like we don't give an effort. But forgetting can take place. This word forget is another verb. So he calls us to action. He calls us to action. It's a verb meaning over time, it can fade in its application to daily living. I will not let your word fade. I will not let your word dissipate in the function of my everyday choices, is what he's saying. See, life can become so busy and so full, a person can lose the presence of truth and purpose that's found in Scripture. You can be very active in church, as we've seen, and lose the authority of Scripture. When you look at the word forget, you'll find that some theologians say this is a great word, but there's two other words that are equally powerful in its translation, because the word, a Hebrew word here for forget, also can mean the word neglect or disregard. To neglect means the failure to take care of properly, to disregard, to pay no attention, or to ignore. So let's look at this. I will not neglect, disregard. I will not fail to take proper care of your word. I will pay attention to it. I will not ignore it. I will not. We have today, there's some 80 plus senior adults on their way to Cape Cod. I'm flying out this afternoon. I'm meeting them in Scranton, Pennsylvania tonight around midnight. I asked them to be in the foyer to welcome me, and they all laughed. I don't know what that's all about. But so I was just, you know, working around the farm yesterday, and it was mow day, and I had to mow somewhere around 6-7 acres. Get ready, it's coming your way, boy. And so I got up, and I got on my tractor mower thing, and I started mowing, and I went down the path, and I looked behind me, and it was all these things sticking up. I'm like, oh shoot, what's going on? If I mow, this is going to look horrible. So I took my tractor back to the shop, and I put it up, and I looked underneath there, and the mowing blades needed some sharpening. So I took off the blades and I sharpened them, and when I went to put them back on, I noticed underneath the deck was all this grass that had collected over multiple mowings through multiple months. And it basically was clogging up the deck. The blades could turn, but it had no place really to throw the grass. It just clumped up and gooped up. And so I took out some tools and I started hacking away at all this. And it started falling to the ground, these clumps of gook and ook and mess. I put the blades back on. I went back out, mowed down, turned around. Looking good. See, my intention the first time was no different than my second attempt. It's just there was a couple of things I had ignored. I had ignored the health of the blade, and I had ignored the health of the deck, and it had become a real mess. Because I was busy, because every time I go to mow, I go, I don't have time to sharpen the blades. I don't have time to clean it up. I got to get out there and mow. Because then it's going to grow right back, and I got to do it again. And every time I go, next time I'm going to sharpen. Next time I'm going to clean it up. And guess what? Next time I didn't do it. And the next time I didn't do it. And the next time I didn't do it. Until finally, it was so bad, there's no way I could successfully take care of the job at hand. I will not forget your word. Life can get so busy, beloved. Life can get so rushed. And you could be flying here and flying there and doing this and doing that and helping here and helping there and go, 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 go. And you're ignoring the condition of a teachable heart. Now let's look at a couple of things. I got 2 minutes. Are you ready? So what am I supposed to do about this? What are these boundaries, this teacher, this mindset of not forgetting? Let me give you just a few things to consider. And listen, this is just some things I thought through. This is not all inclusive. But getting off course in life and out of sync with God's word can happen so easily and so quickly. What are some signs that maybe my life or your life is outside of God's boundaries? What could be some red flags that should be waving in front of us that says maybe there's some neglect and maybe some ignoring going on about God's word? What are some things that may be showing up? They're not the problem. They are a result of a deeper problem. Let me give you five things. Number one, compulsive consuming to make us happy. Compulsive consuming to make us happy. We turn to temporary sources for peace. Food, drink, TV, social media, video games, etc. We buy or consume something in order to make us feel better. Something is unhealthy about that. Now, don't look at me like that. I've been there, you've been there. And I've been around and I've watched it happen. And people engage and buy thinking that's going to bring the peace, thinking that's going to bring the comfort. If I could just do. See, the scripture talks about those things. Second, long-term complaining is a red flag. Now, everybody has a bad day, but it's when days turn into weeks and weeks turn into months, then there's a problem. We're unhappy at work and we're on the look constantly for a new job. We complain about it. We become negative and depressive to those around us. This grows and fills our attitude about most things in life. We just become soul-sucking unhappy. This is a red flag. There's something unhealthy about that. There's something that is in you that needs to be taken back to the plumb line of God's word. If you are that kind of person, just unhappy, unsatisfied, disgruntled, complaining, whining. Third, a higher than unusual self-doubt. This is a red flag. You question every decision or out of whack with yourself. Decisions seem to escape you. You're going a million different directions, but you're going nowhere really fast. Something is unhealthy about that. Scripture talks about our time, and it talks about our health, and it talks about our choices in these things. That doesn't mean we don't ask people for advice. Doesn't mean we don't ask people to pray. Doesn't mean we don't do that. It just means if we're in a place where we're just go, 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 and there's so much self-doubt, it's unhealthy. It's a flag for you. Fourth, you stop taking care of yourself. This is a red flag of leaving or stepping away from the plumb line of God's word, because God's word speaks a lot about our health and taking care of ourselves. You have allowed unhealthy choices to lead you. The discipline to care for yourself, eating healthy, exercising, having daily disciplines, and healthy habits have been kicked to the curb. Because I just feel better holding that gallon of Blue Bell ice cream and zoning out on Netflix. That helps me get through the day. Something unhealthy about that. I love Blue Bell. Number five, you find yourself easily annoyed and stressed out. This is a red flag. When you become especially short with those that are closest to you is a clear sign that something isn't right. The peace of Christ is not really in your heart, and you are in a whirlwind of impossible choices, and you are just stressed out. These are just symptoms. This is not the root. These are not the problem. These are symptoms. That somewhere, for each of these, somewhere we have departed from the plumb line of God's word. And the place of return is always a place of departure. So when I think about boundaries, when I think about the teachings of Christ, when I think about the mindset of I will not forget, our lives can get out of sync with that. And so there's got to be those times where we allow the heart to have a personal checkup and we say, how is my life really going to count? Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget. Every day I'm reading. Every day I'm reminded. Every day I'm personalizing. Every day I'm harmonizing. Every day I'm growing. Every day I'm being stretched. Every day, personally, as a follower of Jesus, I look for those red flags. I look for those signs. I go to God's word and say, God, I'm struggling here. What does your word say? What can I hold on to? What can give me hope? What is the promise? And the promise is this: Jesus will see you through. Here's the beauty of the story. The beauty of the story of everybody in here and everybody watching online. All of us, when we look at these red flags, we can identify. I can. Can you? I can. Man, I wrote those down. I went, I can't talk about this because I'm just showing everybody who I am. It's who we are. It doesn't mean you're unworthy. Let me tell you something. It means that you are so worthy. Why? Because Jesus knew you exactly the way you are, and he loved you, he died for you, he rose again anyway. That's how much he loves you. He knew. And just like that night when he knelt down and he washed the feet of Jesus and looked him in the eye, and he knew. He washes my feet the same way. And he washes your feet the same way. Why? Because that's who Jesus is. Making my life count. Psalms 19, I think, has some pointed thoughts. Let's pray. On the authority of Scripture. But God commended his love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. On the authority of Scripture, If you will confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. On the authority of Scripture, you are to be holy as I am holy. On the authority of Scripture, as many as receive him, they can become the sons of God. On the authority of Scripture, there are boundaries. There's a teacher. There's a mindset. Would you be willing to say yes to this one who loves you the most, this Jesus who died for you, this Jesus who rose again, this Jesus who gave us his living word, this Jesus who gives us the precepts, the statutes, the testimony, the word, this Jesus? Just right there where you sit, trust him, repent, turn, let go of you and grab a hold of him. Jesus, come into my life. I say yes to your hope, your peace, your strength, your comfort, your path, your boundaries. You as the teacher, my mind is set on you today. In the spirit of prayer, just take a moment. We're going to stand and sing in just a second. Our staff and some laymen are coming. They'll be here at the front because we want to have a time of worship before we leave today. Expression of song, of the truth, of the authority of Christ and his word in our lives. If you said yes today, or you want to talk to someone more about saying yes today, or you want to step into Jesus by following him in baptism, or connection to our church, or have someone pray with you or pray over you, the altar will be open during this song. You can come out from where you sit, come and kneel or stand. Someone will come alongside you. If you want to talk, you can talk. If you don't, that's fine. We'd love to help you. We'd love to come alongside you. Say yes to him today. Holy Spirit, living God, fall fresh in this place and on our lives. May we look to you, making our lives count and giving you glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together. Let's sing. And you respond.
Speak,
folks are waiting.
To me when the silence steals my voice. You understand me. You understand me. Come to me. In the valley of unknowns, you understand me. You understand me. You understand me, God. You understand me. Oh, I throw all my cares before you. My doubts and fears don't scare you. You're bigger than I thought. So I stop all negotiations with the God of all creation. You're bigger than I thought you were. You're bigger than I thought you were. God of all creation, you're
Well, thank you again for being here, worshiping with us. Perhaps as Pastor was preaching and just the Lord was working in your heart and your mind, perhaps you know there's maybe a step you need to take or want to take, and maybe just coming down forward and talking to somebody, just maybe what wasn't what you wanted to do today, and that's okay. There's a lot of reasons for that. And so to that end, there's a card in the pew that's right in front of you, also behind you. And just as I said, yes, and there's several different categories. You know, you could be saying, hey, man, this is Jesus. I want to step into a relationship with him. I want to know more about that. Or, and maybe you want to follow and just publicly identify and just say, you know what, I've followed Jesus, but you know what, I've never been baptized, and I would like to do that, or I'd like to know more about that. Or maybe you just have a question about faith, or maybe who we are as a church. There's space for that. And I encourage you, just take a minute or two, jot that down, and you could give that to one of our folks at our connection desk in the lobby, and somebody from our staff team this week will get in touch with you, walk alongside you in that process, whatever it may be. And so I would encourage you, just as Pastor said today, follow the Lord, be obedient, and it might be difficult at times, and that's true, but that doesn't change the fact that it's truth. And it doesn't change the fact that we're called to follow it. And so the great thing is we have the Spirit inside of us as believers to continue to motivate us and push us and lead us to follow the Lord. And so along that journey, no matter where you may be, thank you for being here. Blessings as you go, as we scatter now, may we love our community, all that we go, all the places that we go. Dads, thank you for being dads. Thank you for all that you do, all the hard work, all the things that are seen and unseen. Thank you. Blessings. See you guys Wednesday night in the park.